If you're building in Australia, chances are you will have a slab on ground in your project. Reinforced concrete slab on ground has been used in many parts of Australia for the past decades, especially in the residential building industry. So in this video, we're gonna go through 5 steps to building a residential reinforced concrete slab on ground, along with a couple of tips that can save you money and time. But please, before you build anything, seek for engineering advice. The last thing you want to deal with is foundation problems. Trust me, it's a nightmare. You will need engineering drawings as per the site classification, which is based on the soil reactivity for your specific site. Having said that, get in touch with Incode Engineers in Brisbane, which is the sponsor of this video and the company that I work for. I'll leave the link of the website in the description below. So before you build anything, get in touch with us and we'll make sure we provide you a stress-free project. Before we jump on step number one, I'll give you a quick run through the drawings Incode Engineers would provide you for the construction of a raft slab. First things first, have a good read of the structural notes. Each and every note on this page is relevant to your specific project. Here you find information on site preparation, formwork, foundation notes, earthworks, retaining wall, slab on ground, which is our main focus in this video, concrete notes such as concrete grade, slump, cover, construction joints, control joints, and much more. Moving to sheet S2, the ground floor slab plan shows a layout of the footing and slabs, how thick the slabs are. For example, this one is 100 thick, while this other one is 130 thick. Down here, you've got a couple of the notes and legends specific to the ground floor slab plan. For example, these diagonal bars are crack control bars, which should be placed in all negative corners. These little parallel lines represent dowel bars to connect slabs that will be done in separate pours. This hatch denotes wet area set down, where you might have a bathroom, for example. These dashed lines represent the ground beams. And if we move to sheet S10, or page of details, we'll show you how we want these footings to be constructed. So here is an example of a ground beam, slab thickening, edge thickening, rebate detail for small steps. On these drawings, you will find size, reinforcement, cover, and everything you need to build the structure. Now that you're familiarized with the structural engineer drawings, let's get started with step number one, site preparation and excavation. But before you start any work, get your surveyor to provide you all information you need about the site. You don't want to build your house in the wrong location. The actual ground preparation starts by scraping off the topsoil and any loose material. Then you're going to level and compact the subsoil, which has just been uncovered. A reasonably uniform foundation is essential to long-term performance. Next, you're going to dig out the shape of the edge and internal beams and any necessary surrounding drainage trenches. We recommend using a blinding layer of sand because it helps to protect the membrane on rough ground. Step number two, install service pipes and a membrane. At this stage, the plumber will install all the pipes which are to be covered by the slab. Termite mesh will also have to be fitted to all pipes. That black plastic you see on top of the soil is the vapor barrier. As the name suggests, it's a barrier against vapor rising through the soil and bringing moisture into the house. Remember, it's not waterproofing. Waterproofing a concrete slab is a completely different process. If you're located in South Australia or New South Wales, you should use a damp-proofing membrane instead of a vapor barrier. Damp-proofing membrane is high impact resistant, while vapor barrier is medium impact resistant. Step number three, install the reinforcement. Steel reinforcement is necessary in all edge and internal beams, as well as in the slab panel. Typically, the beams are 300 millimeters wide with a trench mesh in the bottom. The slab, on the other hand, will have sheets of mesh everywhere. If you lay the steel close to the ground, it will rust and fail. That's why you need bar chairs. Bar chair is a plastic support placed under the reinforcement to hold the steel away from the ground and prevent corrosion. Another important point here is that in case you decide to pour a strip footing first and then the slab in a second pour, you must install starter bars in the strip footing to connect to the slab. You also need 3 and 12 reentrant bars, 2 meters long, to all negative corners, as I've shown on the plans. Step number 4, place the concrete and finish the slab surface. For most of the jobs, concreters will pour the footings and slabs using a concrete truck and a pump. You can use a boom pump or a line pump. If it is a large project, you're better off using a boom pump. If you decide to use a line pump or something else, just be careful not to knock the bar chairs over. The minimum concrete grade to be used is N20 with slump between 80 and 100 millimeters and 20 millimeters aggregate. Just a side note, if you're doing a polished concrete slab, I would recommend bumping that up to N32 grade concrete and using SL81 or 92 mesh. Do not add water to the concrete on site. It does get easier to work with, however, it will get weaker, crack more, and result in a poor surface finish. A mechanical vibrator should be used to compact the concrete. Hold the vibrator straight up and keep it in the same position until bubbles stop rising to the surface. This will ensure the concrete is evenly consolidated and free from entrapped air. Make the concrete surface smooth and level with a screeding board. Last but not least, step number 5, cure the concrete slab. This is one of the most important steps if you want to keep your slab free of visible cracks. In simple terms, as the concrete dries out, it shrinks, and if the concrete shrinks before it gains enough strength, it cracks. So curing involves holding water in the concrete and allowing it to gain strength. Cure the concrete continuously for at least 3 days or 7 days, depending on the exposure classification. You can also use curing compounds to reduce the loss of water. Following these 5 steps will give you a high quality slab on ground that will last a lifetime. If you have any questions about slab on ground, just leave a comment below. Don't forget to like the video and subscribe to the channel, and I'll see you next time.